Can we start? What do you say? Or should we wait?
I'm just waiting for this 2 minute lag in the YouTube. Whenever you say it live, it takes about a minute, minute and a half. Yeah, we are live now. So welcome everybody for one more edition of BOA PG lectures. Today the topic is perimetry A to Z, a very important topic, not only from your clinical practice, but also from exam vivas. Because then this is one chart which is always given to the students to read out. More so important to evaluate the patient of glaucoma. This is still the gold standard, though we have other imaging techniques. And to take this lecture, we have with us Dr. Anu. And she's PG from Maulana Azad Medical College. And she's done pediatric as well as glaucoma fellowship from there. And at present, she's working as a consultant at the same hospital, if I'm not wrong.
I did my PhD in Karnataka, but yeah, my senior residency and training in Guru Nanak Rai Center.
So thank you, Anu. And thank you, Dr. Sumil, for getting her to talk here. So we are all looking forward for your lecture. I would request all the PGs to keep their videos off. But keep putting in your questions, and we would be asking few PGs to volunteer themselves to read out few perimetry reports at the end. So hang on till the end, and yeah, we can begin now.
Hi everyone, good evening. Hope you're having a good day. I'd like to thank BOA and Dr. Sumit and Dr. Swapnesh at the outset for giving me this opportunity to interact with you all. And even though Dr. Swapnesh said to hold on till the end, I'll not let you hold on till the end, don't worry. So we'll have an interactive session, and I would like you all to have your fingers ready on the type chats, because from the start to the end, we'll have a lot of question answer sessions. And even if you're wrong, even if you have doubts, just write something so that we know how much you know and what are your doubts and how we can clarify them further. Okay, so we'll start my screen sharing. Yeah.
Visible.
Right. I'm Dr. Anu Jhul, an assistant professor in glaucoma services in Guru Nanak Eye Center, Maulana Azad Medical College, New Delhi. And today I'll be taking you through perimetry. And by perimetry, we're talking more in terms of glaucoma rather than other neurological or other perimetries. And we'll be going through the basics of reading a visual field chart. You've had previous sessions in April and other times for glaucoma as well as perimetry. So this will not be a theoretical session or, you know, definitions and those sorts of things that you can go through the books. We'll go through practical aspects and very, very simple aspects. So it's not complicated at all. Very basic presentation. So hope all of you participate actively. Let's start. So when we talk about perimetry, what comes to our mind first is the Treques Island of Vision. So as you can see here, this is a 2D plot, okay, which shows a 60 degree field of view in nasally. That is, a human eye can see 60 degrees nasally, around the same 60 degrees superiorly, slightly more, that is 70 degrees inferiorly, and around 100 degrees temporally. So this is a 2D plot, and when it is plotted in a three dimension, it's called the hill of vision. Okay, you can see here this tip. That is, this tip is the fixation or the fovea, which has maximum sensitivity. So in this 2D plot, you cannot see where is the maximum sensitivity or which is the minimum. However, in a 3D plot, you can see the maximum sensitivity is at the fovea. There's a peak. And then it gradually falls towards the periphery on either sides, okay? Temporally up to 100 degrees and nasally a steep fall at 60 degrees. So when you talk about this, if you plot this in a 2D, this is the hill, okay? So this is again fovea going 90 to 100 degrees temporally and 60 degrees nasally. Now, what is this? Can anybody tell me in the chat, or you can unmute yourselves? Why do we have this sharp defect here? What is this? Somebody in the chat. This might go on for more than an hour if you take longer time to write in the chat, because I won't proceed or tell you the answers. Yeah, so we have a response here. Somebody says it's a blind spot, correct? So it's a blind spot. Now my doubt is, this is the optic nerve head and all my retinal nerve fibers are going through the optic nerve head. So why is it showing as a scotoma? Why does it show as a scotoma when all the nerve fiber layers are concentrated in the optic nerve head? They're going from the retina through the optic nerve head on behind, posteriorly. Exactly. So there are no photoreceptors to perceive the object, and hence it is seen as a scotoma. Now, in the central area, you have an absolute scotoma. Okay. So this absolute scotoma is by the optic nerve head, okay, as well as the surrounding beta zone. Okay. Whereas you can have a relative scotoma just against it, which is by the alpha zone. All right. Now, when we're talking about perimetry, we need to have a background illumination. So charting these fields is called perimetry. And whenever you're doing any particular testing strategy or a test, all your parameters have to be constant and reproducible so that you can follow the patient over a period of time. So now this background illumination, say, is marginally photopic. So, you know, when you take the patients for a perimetry, you have a dark room. Okay, it's not absolutely pitch dark, but it's not really bright. So why is it not bright? Why don't we do a photopic perimetry? It is marginally photopic. Can somebody respond? Why is it not photopic? I think you can unmute yourselves. It's not absolutely scotopic, but it is not photopic either. Any guesses? Okay, so if we take a photopic perimetry, you'll have cones in the center. And cones are more sensitive to color instead of the general light stimulus. So the peak that you saw, okay, this peak will be depressed. That is why you do not do a photopic. It will reflect a falsely low sensitive retina. Okay. And why not an why is it marginally photopic? Because the periphery of the retina, when you have the fundus, this periphery of the retina has cones, or the mid periphery. Cones respond to a slightly less photopic stimulus. So this increases the sensitivity of the test. And that is why you perform a perimetry in a slightly darker room. Okay. And this background illumination has to be constant so that all our fields are reproducible. So most of our tests that we do, we have a background illumination of around 31.5 apostils. This is the unit of illumination. Okay. Now with the background, you need to also take care of the stimulus illumination or the intensity. Now, what is the stimulus intensity? Okay, stimulus intensity is generally described in, again, apostils. Now you have the maximum stimulus is 10,000 apostils. But when we're talking about perimetry, we are not bothered how bright is the stimulus. We are bothered more about the retina. Okay, how sensitive is the retina? So when we talk about sensitivity, it is described in decibels. And this decibels is inversely proportional to the stimulus intensity. And what do we mean by this? The more bright the stimulus, that means the patient requires a brighter stimulus, means his retina is less sensitive. Okay, so there is more damage, probably less sensitive. That is why he requires a very bright light. Now, if he requires less intense stimulus, that means his retina is more sensitive. So a 10,000 apostils corresponds to a 0 decibels. Of retinal sensitivity. And this is described in logarithmic units. Okay, so 10,000 is 0. So 1,000 becomes 10 decibels. 100 apostils is 20 decibels. 10 is 30 decibels. 1 is 40 decibels. So if you see a 40 decibel sensitivity in your field anywhere, that means the patient will respond to as low as 1 apostils of stimulus. Okay. And the least that we go is 0.08, which corresponds to 51 decibels. Okay, so apostils range from 10,000 to almost zero, and the sensitivity ranges from 0 to 51. Now, this is in Humphrey's visual field. There's a slight difference when we talk about a different field called as octopus, where 1,000 apostils corresponds to 0 decibels. Okay, so this is a slight difference. However, we do not commonly use octopus in most centers. So it is all right if you know about the Humphreys. Okay, the stimulus intensity again can be changed. Okay. Coming to the size of the stimulus. Now, what is the size of the stimulus? Size has been described by which person? Can anybody tell me who gave the sizes of the stimulus? That is 0 to 5. Goldman, very nice. So Goldman described these sizes in a kinetic perimetry. That was a Goldman perimetry, which came in first before all these Humphreys came in. Now this size zero corresponds to a 1/16 millimeter square of stimulus. Okay. And with each size, there will be a fourfold increase in the size of the stimulus. So if 0 is 1/16, 1 is 1/4 mm square, 2 is 1 mm square, 3 is 4 mm square, 4 is 16 mm square, and 5 is 64 mm square. Okay, very easy. Stimulus 3 is the most commonly used stimulus, which is 4 mm square. And it generally projects an angle of 0.43 degrees onto the retina. So you need to know this size because it is commonly asked, what is the stimulus size 3? Okay, you also sometimes use a stimulus 5. So you need to know these stimulus sizes. Also, you need to keep the stimulus size constant when you're doing various fields so that the fields are reproducible. However, if a patient does not see a smaller stimulus size, you can increase it. Okay. Increasing the stimulus size by 2 will increase the decibel or the sensitivity of a point by 5. Okay. This is called as spatial summation. Increasing the space or size of the stimulus will increase the retinal sensitivity. Coming to exposure time, you can increase the exposure time, and this will again lead to the patient perceiving the stimulus better. This is called temporal summation in time. Now the exposure time in a Humphrey field is kept constant at 0.02 seconds. Sorry, 0.0 seconds, okay? 0.2 seconds or 200 milliseconds, whereas in octopus, it is kept at 0.1 seconds or 100 milliseconds. Again, you have various programs like threshold and supra-threshold. In supra-threshold, the stimulus time is more, okay? So that the patient can perceive these better as they are used for screening. Coming on to the next parameter, that is the type of perimetry. You have kinetic and you have static. So what do you mean by these? Kinetic perimetry means, just a minute. Yeah. So kinetic perimetry means that the stimulus is moving. So here you see this field of vision, and the stimulus is moving from one point to another point, going towards the peak and then going in the other direction. So the stimulus is moving. Okay, it always goes from a non-seeing area to a seeing area. Okay, so if you have a scotoma somewhere in the center, you have to chart the scotoma in the opposite direction, again from non-seeing to the seeing area. Okay, the point at which the patient starts to see is called the isopter. So you chart all the four quadrants, and at the point where the patient starts to see, it's called an isopter or a contour line after you join all those points. And stimulus is generally moved in the 2 to 4 degrees per second to have more reproducible results. Okay. Whereas in static perimetry, your stimulus is static. It is, one stimulus is presented at one point, then a different stimulus will be presented at a different point. Again, a different stimulus at a different point. It is not the same stimulus which is moving continuously. So this is static. Now the sensitivity of kinetic is better than the static perimetry. However, it takes longer, and plus this needs a trained perimetrist. That is why more commonly performed procedure is static nowadays. Okay. But remember, the sensitivity of kinetic is much better than static. Coming to manual versus automated perimetry. In manual, again, an individual perimetrist needs to perform this manually. So you can have tangent screens, okay, where the stimulus will be presented at different locations and the patient will see. Or you could have an arc where the stimulus will be presented. Or you can have a bowl, okay. So it can be done in different ways. And there are various techniques, the supra-threshold and threshold techniques. We'll be talking about these later. Whereas in an automated perimetry, the machine itself will be projecting out the stimulus at different points, okay? Now, when you have a perimeter, you have a computer screen and a bowl. So this computer screen is called as control unit, okay? Whereas this bowl is called as the perimetric unit. Now, in this bowl, stimuli are shown at different points. These stimuli can be either projected from one source in different directions, or there can be LED bulbs embedded inside. Okay, now what is preferred is this target projection, because in this way you can vary the stimulus intensity as well as the stimulus size. However, when you're using LED illumination, because these are slightly depressed, these areas, so when the light comes from a depression or a hole, it will appear to be brighter and hence will be perceived falsely better. So this is called as a dark hole phenomenon. However, most perimeters use a target projection method and not an LED illumination. Coming to the testing strategies and patterns, you can stop me if there's any confusion at any point. Okay. How do we know that the patient is fixing in the center? Because the fixation is a key to performing this perimetry. The patient has to keep fixing in the center. And because you're charting the peripheral degrees, so these light are falling on the peripheral or the mid-peripheral retina. So you need to know that he is fixing. This can be done with the TV view. So on your screen, the control unit, you'll have a small box where the patient's photo will be appearing. So you know that the patient is fixing, or by a corneal reflex. Sometimes in this control unit, you have the photo of an eye with the cornea and a central reflex. So you know he's fixing. You have this Hegel-Krakow blind spot tracking. Can anybody unmute and tell me what is this? What is this Hegel-Krakow method that is commonly used now in almost all the parameters, perimeters? Anyone? Or any parameter which is reflecting this blind spot tracking? So what happens is, generally, a stimulus is presented randomly in between the tests at the blind spot. Now, and ideally, a patient should not see that stimulus, okay? Somebody has written fixation losses, very nice. So it is reflected as fixation losses, because ideally if it is presented at the blind spot, you are not supposed to see it. But if the patient still sees, that means he is not focusing centrally. So this stimulus which was to fall on the blind spot has actually fallen somewhere else. So this reflects as fixation loss. So a fixation loss of 6/18 would mean 18 times the stimulus was projected onto the blind spot, and 6 of those times the patient saw it. That means he was not fixing. Okay, so this is the Hegel-Krakow blind spot tracking. And you have the gaze tracker. So sometimes in the fields, you see a small tracker below towards the end. Okay. So this is a gaze tracker. It will tell you throughout the test time, how was the gaze of the patient. If the gaze goes below, that means he closed his eyes. Okay. If the gaze goes up, that means he was moving. Okay. Smaller fluctuations are preferable rather than larger amplitude fluctuations for more reliability of the test. Coming to testing strategies, the stimuli are randomly presented. So if one stimulus is presented in one quadrant, the next stimulus might not be somewhere near it. It will be in some other quadrant so that the patient does not anticipate it. So to prevent this anticipation, you have a random presentation of the objects and by an adaptive technique. So basically, the relative differential threshold is seen at different points. Now we know this is the normal curve of the fovea. So stimulus, if it was a single threshold stimulus that was presented, it will not be able to chart these lower areas or higher areas. So charting is done with the threshold that is following this curve so as to detect early changes. Okay, this is relative differential light threshold. So light threshold of this point is relatively different from this. Okay, relative differential. Now you have other strategies such as supra threshold and threshold. What does this mean? Supra threshold means that if we are expecting a particular threshold at this point, we are expecting the threshold to be maybe 35, we present more than that. Okay. So around 8 dBs more than that, if you're presenting, the patient will be able to see. So he will respond faster and hence it will take less time. So it is a screening strategy. Whereas in threshold, we present a stimulus that is somewhere around the intensity of this normal point by a staircasing or a bracketing pattern. So we do not know what is the exact sensitivity for this patient, but we know the sensitivity for an age-related, age-matched population. So we present a similar stimulus. Once a patient sees a stimulus, we will decrease the threshold by 4 decibels. He still sees it. We again decrease it by 4 dB. Now he cannot see it. So we start increasing the stimulus intensity again, but this time by 2 decibels. Okay, the initial staircase was 4 decibels and now we have 2 decibels. He is still not able to see it. So we again increase it by 2 decibels until he sees it again. So the same point is crossed twice. Okay, so this is double crossing of the threshold or 4-2 bracketing. Okay, this is followed in Humphrey's visual field. Whereas you also have a 4-2-1 threshold testing, which is done in octopus. Okay, so this is the thresholding. So because each point is tested so meticulously, it takes longer time. However, it is more predictable, okay, and more reflective of the glaucomatous damage or abnormal damage. Then you also have a fast pack strategy where each point is crossed only once. Okay, this makes it faster. You again have another strategy called as CETA. Can somebody tell me the full form of CETA? What does this stand for? What does CETA stand for? It is a newer
Swedish
type. Yeah,
Swedish interactive testing algorithm.
So is it testing algorithm or is it thresholding algorithm?
Swedish interactive thresholding algorithm.
Correct. So how is it different from this normal threshold? In this CETA, basically, if you're testing various points, you have tested one point. So rather than starting again, testing the new point by different threshold, you will extrapolate this threshold. If this threshold was 35, you expect the nearby point to have a similar threshold. Okay, so it is extrapolating the threshold of the surrounding points to test this point. Okay, so this makes it faster. Rather than starting from scratch, it is starting from a prefixed value. So it extrapolates. Okay, also it takes in the response time of the patient. So if the response time of the patient is faster, that means he can see better, so he's responding better. So it makes it faster. It takes into consideration this response time. So CETA is also available in standard form as well as in fast. The CETA standard takes half the time as a threshold, whereas CETA fast takes half the time as this fast pack. However, this decrease in time is not standard for all patients. Only in early damage or in no damage, you'll have a fast test because these points can be tested quickly. But if there is advanced damage, the patient might not respond to the surrounding stimuli. So they will have to be checked again and again until the patient responds. So in advanced damage, the CETA might take a similar time too. So it is not standardized that it will always be fast. It depends upon the patient's clock damage. Okay.
Ma'am, can thresholding be changed in the middle of a test?
No, it cannot be. You have to decide these parameters right at the start of the test. Okay. And you have to perform the test completely. Also, when you're comparing different tests, so make sure your parameters remain the same over sequence. Okay. So if you're choosing threshold in the first test, do not take CETA in the next test. You will not be able to compare. So if you have to compare sequential fields, all your parameters, whether it be your background illumination, whether it be your stimulus illumination, size, the testing strategy, all these need to be constant. Unless there is
a particular indication. Ma'am, how to decide which strategy to use for which patient, like when to use CETA standard, when to use CETA fast?
So we generally use a CETA fast, okay, because the patients are unable to sit for longer durations in the CETA standard. However, if the patient is giving more false responses to this, or there is more damage, and we want a full standard test to isolate the sensitivity at each point, then we go in for a CETA standard. So right now, we go in for the fastest strategies. Okay. So the similar variant, CETA, is available in Humphreys. Okay. A similar test is available in Octopus, which is called as TOP. Now, what is the full form of this? Someone? What's the full form of TOP? The principle remains similar, that is extrapolation of the surrounding points, and it is again faster, but this is available in octopus, and the other theta is available in Humphrey. So this is tendency oriented perimetry. Okay, just a minute, my presentation keeps getting stuck. Okay, so we have other newer modalities also. We have the SWAP, that is short wavelength automated perimetry. Then we have FDT, frequency doubling, high pass resolution, and random motion. We'll be discussing these towards the end. Coming to fixation patterns. Now, how do we decide where to fix the patient? When you start the test in the central bowl, you see a small dot. So that is the central point where you'll have a yellow light. And below this, you will see these four circles and other four circles inside it. Okay. So this is a central fixation. This is a large diamond, which is below it. And this is a small diamond. Okay. So you always ask the patient to fix centrally. Only if he is not able to fix centrally, he has some macular pathology, or there's eccentric fixation, or he has very poor vision, you ask him to fix on these diamonds. Okay, so this highlights, the yellow highlights the central fixation, whereas this highlights the diamond fixation. So central fixation is preferred. Now, which test to take, which testing patterns to do? So you have screening tests as well as threshold tests. Screening tests are generally not done because you always see the patient's fundus first, and only if you have a doubt of glaucoma, you go in for visual testing. Okay, and in those cases, you prefer a threshold test. Okay, these can test the central field or the peripheral field, or you can have separate neurological tests. Now, central field, the glaucoma affects which degrees of field? Can somebody tell me which degrees of field are affected most commonly by glaucoma? Is it perifoveal? Is it peripheral? Is it mid-peripheral? Or is it central? And how much degrees? I can't see the chat box. Yeah, so something is popping up now. All right, so 30 degrees, right? But does it affect 0 degree or 5 degree initially? So how much degrees to how much degree? Can you be more precise? So generally the field damages are seen between 10 to 30 degrees, okay? Correct. So you can have 30-2, 24-2, 10-2, and these macular programs as central. So this 30 means you're testing 30 degrees. This means you're testing 24 degrees, 10 degrees, and specifically the macula. What is this two? We'll be discussing shortly. Okay. In peripheral fields, you can check 60 degrees. Here, you're not checking the complete 60. You're checking 30 degrees to 60 degrees. You're not checking the central 30. Okay. So central tests are done mainly for glaucoma, or when you have some macular pathology, you do macular tests. Whereas these peripheral tests are important. Can somebody name a condition where you would like to go in for a peripheral test? Something like a 60-4? CRVO, okay. What else? RP, very good. So retinitis pigmentosa is one very important indication to do a peripheral test because it affects the peripheral fields. Anything else? Something to do with diabetes? Anything to do with diabetes? Can we subject a diabetic patient to these tests? Why? Why only diabetic retinopathy or anything in particular? Any particular treatment for diabetic retinopathy? So a patient who has undergone PRP, very nice. Post PRP, you go in for a peripheral test because this is known to constrict the visual fields. Okay. So peripheral fields are indicated in this. You also have a peripheral nasal step. So what is the indication of this peripheral nasal step? This is for glaucoma, okay, early glaucoma, because glaucoma is known to affect the nasal areas initially. Okay, also you can have a temporal crescent, and neurological fields, generally you do a full field 120 or neurological 20 and neurological 30 degrees. Now let's discuss what we mean by one and two. Okay, you have the one pattern, you have the one pattern and you have the dash two pattern. So when you're doing a field, you can see this is the horizontal meridian and the vertical meridian. Here you can see the points are not lying on these meridians, but they are offset. Whereas there can be a test where the points are lying on these meridians Okay. So these two tests are different. This is a dash two strategy and this is a dash one. A dash one means the testing points lie on the horizontal and the vertical meridian also. Whereas in dash two, they are offset. Now you see most of our tests are dash two, 24-2, 30-2, 10-2. Why? Because this gives you a bare area. These points are separated by 6 degrees. Okay. So 3 degrees above, 3 degrees below. So there's a bare area of 6. But if we had to do these points, this would be 6 degrees and this would be 6 degrees. So this would include a bare area of 12. Or basically the distance from the fixation. The bare area would be 6, here it will be 3. So bearing from this point, the meridian would be 3 degrees. Here it would be 6 degrees. But your 12 degrees, you'll not be able to know what exactly happened here. Okay, so you prefer a dash 2 pattern. Now in 30-2, you're checking the central 30 degrees. All these points are placed 6 degrees apart. So you have 6, 12, 18, 24 and 30 in each direction. This is 30, 30, 30 and 30. And you have this 30 written here. Okay. So no point on the axis because it is a dash 2 pattern. The point density is 6 degrees apart and it checks total of 76 points with a bare area of 3 degree offset from the meridians. Okay. In dash 1, this remains same. This becomes different. Okay. The density remains same. The points tested are different and the bare area becomes 6 degree. Now, how is this 30 pattern different from a 24 pattern? So you can see here, this is 6, this is 12, this is 18, and this is 24. And it stops here. This is the edge of 30 degrees and the points have stopped short of this. So this is a 24 degrees. This again is 24 degrees. This is also 24 degrees. But what is different here is that these two points have been tested extra. They're reaching up to 30. Okay. This is the temporal area and this is the nasal area. So in 24-2, it is not a uniform 24 degrees, but two points in the 30 degrees are tested nasally to unmask the early nasal defects. Okay. So it is only the temporal field that is changing. Temporally, you're having 24 degrees, but nasally, it still remains 30 degrees. Okay. So it is not uniform that way. And it helps to unmask early damage in the nasal area. So it is testing 24 degrees, the dash two pattern, so no point on the axis. Again, 6 degrees apart and a bare area of 3. And the only difference in dash one would be points will be on the axis with the bare area becoming 6 degrees. You also have a nasal step pattern. Okay, this comes in the peripheral area. So this is checking between 30 and 50. Because you can check these areas in 30 degrees in the 24-2 and 30-2. And beyond that, now this is 10. 20, now this is 30. So 30, 40 and 50. So you're checking 2 points above and 2 points below in each of these isopters. Okay. So you have total of 14 points. These are 12 points and 2 separate eccentric points are checked for the early defects. Now, when we're talking about these defects, what defects do we expect? So whenever you send the patient for perimetry, you should always know what you are expecting. Okay, do not just randomly see the fundus. Okay, it looks glaucomatous, just send. Always try to have a diagnosis in mind and what you're expecting to happen. So you could have a peripheral loss. You could have localized nerve fiber defects. So you have the superior arcuate fibers, inferior arcuate fibers, superior radiating, inferior radiating, and the papillomacular bundle. So the ganglion cells that are damaged will reflect a nerve fiber defect in that particular area. You could have superior arcuate defects, or inferior arcuate defects, or total arcuate or ring scotomas. Okay, you can have concentric contraction of the field, that is a crowding of peripheral nasal isopters, a generalized or a central depression, enlargement of the blind spot. Now this enlargement is called as bearing. Okay, it could be true or false. So what is true and what is false? So when your isopter is almost reaching the temporal edge of the blind spot, now this will join and so it will not reflect. And bearing means exposure. Okay, so it feels that this has been exposed, but actually it is coming abutting the temporal edge of the isopter. That is why this is a false bearing. Okay, but when the isopter has actually contracted and the blind spot falls outside of this, this is a true bearing. You can have temporal sector defects and advanced glaucomatous defects. So here you can see this is 10 degrees and 20 degrees and 30 degrees. You have the blind spot. This is the centroscotoma. This is the centroid fovea. This is a paracentroscotoma. This is a cedar scotoma, a scotoma which is starting from and joining the blind spot. Okay, it can extend and form a arcuate scotoma, a superior arcuate or an inferior arcuate. And when both of them join, it becomes a ring scotoma or a double arcuate. Okay. Now, what are the factors which affect these visual fields? Sorry. So it could be physiological factors like age, because the neural loss starts at around 20 years. So what is the amount of neural loss that happens in decades? Can anybody tell me?
Dr. Anu?
Yeah.
This is Dr. Swapnesh.
Yeah, Dr.
By 8 o'clock, are we going to wind up or it's going to extend a bit?
I think it'll extend a bit. Is that okay?
Yeah, maybe by 5-10 minutes, it's okay.
All right, I'll try to wind up by 8.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. So there's a 1 decibel loss every decade after the age of 20 years. Okay. Pupil size is important. It has to be at least 3 to 3.5 because if it is small, there'll be contraction of the field. Okay. If it is more, if it's a midriatic pupil, you need not worry. There are certain people who do a midriatic peripheral, midriatic field on routine basis. Refractive errors have to be corrected because they can cause a blur on the retina. And so they'll decrease the sensitivity. And these are called as refraction scotomas. So for every degree diopter of refractive error, a 1 decibel sensitivity decreases, whether it be uncorrected or overcorrected. Okay, there'll be a decrease in the sensitivity. And hyperopia and astigmatism are more known to cause refraction scotomas than myopia. The media needs to be clear. You can also have learning effects. Okay, so the first field generally is not taken to be the standard. You need to have 2 baseline fields before you start commenting on the progression. Okay, and fatigue, because there'll be lid drooping and there can be artificial arcuates.
Ma'am, one doubt.
Yeah.
Can we start directly with 30-2 or we have to first do 24-2 for the patient?
You can do either, but we generally prefer a 24-2 because in 24-2 also in the nasal area, you're covering the 30 points. Okay. So your nasal step or any nasal defect will be covered even in the 24-2. So you could directly go for a 24-2. Some people do.
And when to know that now we need to go for a 30-2 in a patient after doing 24-2?
If it's a patient of glaucoma, a 24-2 is considered a standard. You need not go for a 30-2 after a 24-2. If you're following up a patient sequentially, prefer to do the same testing strategy. Okay, 24-2 is good enough. You need not go in for a 30-2.
Okay, does the pattern strategy depend upon the cup disc ratio?
You mean to say the threshold or supra threshold?
Yeah, 24-2 or 30-2 to decide based on the cup disc ratio can be.
Glaucoma, like we said, would affect 10 to 20 degrees of the field. So 10 to 20 degrees would be covered in a 24-2. Okay, so it does not depend upon the extent, but yes, if it is an advanced damage, advanced cup 0.9, and your 24-2 reflects highly advanced losses, then you need to go in for more smaller programs like a 10-2 or a macular program, but not the higher ones. Okay, it's the other way around.
Okay.
Now, before we start to read the fields, quickly tell me which perimeter is this. It's a gold standard perimeter. Projection perimetry. Okay, so targets are projected. It's a kinetic perimetry. It's a gold standard which first came in. What's the name of this perimeter? Come on, quick. I've got a time foundation now. It's a Goldman. Very good. Presentation keeps getting stuck. What about this one? Yeah, this is an arc perimeter. What about this? Quick, it's written on this perimeter. It's an octopus, okay? And what about this one? This everybody should know. This is a Humphreys, okay? Sorry, I'm unable to proceed with the slides. Yeah. So now quickly tell me, is this the right eye or the left eye? This is very basic. Although you have these things written on the field chart, but you need to not search around for that. This is the left eye. Why do you say so? Can you unmute yourself and tell?
Blind spot.
Yeah, you have to look for this blind spot. Okay. Now the blind spot, the optic disc is always nasal to the fovea and hence it is projected in the temporal space. Okay. Because it is projected in the temporal space, consider yourself and your eyes. If it was your right eye, this would be temporal and this would be nasal. Okay. But if it was your left eye, this would be nasal and this would be temporal. Now the blind spot lies temporally and hence it is the left eye. What about this? Here, the blind spot is lying in the temporal field. This is either the temporal area of the right eye or the nasal area of the left eye. So which one is it? Come on.
Temporal.
So this is temporal of your right eye. So blind spot lies temporally, hence it is the right eye. Correct. Now, is this a 24-2 or a 30-2? You will
24-2.
Yeah, all these things written on the chart, but you need to be so quick and such expertise in field charting or field reading that you just see this and you can guess. So here 30 is written, but these points are not progressing up to 30. They're falling short and the blind spot extends up to 20. So this is near that. So this is 24. However, the shape also gives you a clue because the extra points are tested nasally. So this is a 24-2. What about this?
30-2.
Because the points are reaching up to 30. 30 is written here. Okay. And the blind spot is lying between 10 to 20. This is a right eye. And this is again a right eye. So now this is a 30-2 or a 10-2? You have these two. Why is it not coming?
Dash two.
Yeah, so you have these two fields, which is 30-2 and which is 10-2. Both of
above
these
above one is 30-2.
Okay.
And why do one is, ma'am, because blind spot is included in the... Right.
So when you have the blind spot mapped, so it has to be more than 10 degrees. This is 10 and this is 20. So this is 30-2. Whereas in 10-2, it is limiting at 10. So you do not have any blind spot mapped in this 10-2. Okay. Now, which is this testing strategy? Is it a threshold strategy or is it a CETA strategy? You have certain clues here and you have certain clues here. If you're seeing on your laptops, you'll be able to read them. Come on, quick. Just speak up. I think writing and then me reading it takes double the time. So unmute and speak.
CETA.
Wrong. Anybody else? Any other guesses? Any other guesses?
Mm-hmm.
This is a threshold strategy because in a threshold strategy, certain random points are checked twice. So can you see these bracket areas? Your 13 is written here and in the bracket 19 is written. So in a threshold strategy, so certain random points are checked twice after they have been mapped the first time, just to see if there's any intra-test variation. This intra-test variation is called the short-term fluctuation. So these double testings gives rise to a short-term fluctuation or the intra-test variation, which is seen only in threshold. CETA does not have this parameters. Okay. And this corrected pattern standard deviation is PSD minus the short-term fluctuation. The short-term fluctuation should be ideally 1 to 2 decibels and not more than that. This is a CETA because there is no
double test
and no double test. Now coming to finally the visual field interpretation. Now this is a visual field of a patient. Everything is written on this. Okay. So it is a single field. Sorry. Yeah. Give me a moment. Mm-hmm. Okay. So it is a single field analysis. Okay. The patient details are mentioned here so that you can follow up the patient. The eye is mentioned here. Now you can know the eye from this also, right eye. So why is it mentioned, or what is this importance of selecting the correct eye? The thing is, if you select the right eye, the blind spot will be mapped according to the right eye. So if the patient's left eye is being tested and you've selected right, the blind spot will be mapped wrongly, and hence your whole field will go haywire. Okay. The date of birth is important because it helps to deduce the age, and age-related normative database is used to compare these fields from the general population. You have the central testing strategy, which tests 30 degrees in a dash-to fashion in a threshold manner. The fixation is done by gaze tracking, that is here, and blind spot monitoring by the fixation losses. It's a stimulus size 3, that is 4 mm square, with a white stimulus on a white background of 31.5 apostils. Pupil diameter needs to be correct, 3 to 3.5. Visual acuity has to be 6 by 6 to prevent any refraction errors. And this visual acuity should correspond to the foveal sensitivity. Date is important to follow them sequentially, and age again, as I mentioned before. Okay, now this is all the patient related data and the testing strategies. Coming on to this area, that is the your fixation losses and false positive, false negative. These are the reliability indices. These reliability indices initially were considered as up to 33% reliable, but now we consider 15 to 20% reliability. Okay, so anything more than that would make it unreliable. Fixation losses here means 16 times it was projected onto the blind spot, wherein 2 times the patient responded. False positive, the importance is, this is 4%. If the false positives are high, I would have less of interaction now and more of teaching so that we finish on time. Okay. So 4% would mean that 4% of the times there was no stimulus, but the patient pressed the trigger. So it is a trigger happy patient. This increases the sensitivity of all these points and brings out a white field. Okay. It's called a white out field. False negative errors. Here it is 0%. It means if it was 5%, it would mean that 5% of the times the stimulus was presented, but the patient did not respond. A high false negative error would give rise to peripheral scotomas. Okay, we will discuss about this a little later. So false positives you generally reject. If it is a high false negative error, there is one condition that you should not reject it outrightly, because even in advanced damage, advanced glaucoma, the patient will not be able to see when a stimulus is presented. So it could actually mean that the patient has advanced damage instead of just a poor reliability. The test duration generally corresponds to the strategy that you have used, SITA standard. Okay. Now, this was the reliability indices. Now, this is the numerical data or numerical plot where the sensitivity of each point is noted. So the blind spot is 0 decibels here. The peripheral points are 35, 36 decibels, and the peripheral points are somewhere around 17, 18, 21. Okay. This has been projected as a grayscale. Here, each tone, each different tone suggests a change in 5 decibel intensity. As you can see here, 50, 40, and then you have 30 in decrements of 5, 35, 30, 25, 20. You have different colors, or pixels rather. Then after this numerical data in grayscale, you have the total deviation, total deviation numerical data and the probability plot. So here the age-related normative database has been taken in by the machine, and from the numerical data, it has been subtracted. So here zero means an absolute scotoma, which is bad, but here zero would mean that this is corresponding to the average person of that particular age. Okay, zero doesn't mean bad, zero is average. Okay, so So a pattern deviation, how do you calculate? So if you were to take this point, minus one, minus, plus one, okay? So minus one, minus this one. So it becomes minus two. That is how you deduce this plot or the pattern deviation. So this total deviation keeps into account the generalized loss depending upon the patient's factors, if he has cataract or other causes of decrease in vision. Pattern deviation is specific to glaucoma. Okay, so all the local factors have been deduced. So you have the pattern deviation numerical plot and then the pattern deviation probability plot, again with these probability indices. Then you have the global indices. You have the mean deviation, which is a mean of these points with more weightage given to the central points. And minus means it is less than normal or less than average. You have the pattern standard deviation, which is a deduction of these points, given again more weightage to the central points. This probability means only less than 10% of the average population of this age will have such a plot. Okay, 90% will have a better plot, only less than 10% will have this plot. Visual field index is a new global index, ranges from 0 to 100%. 100% means it is absolutely normal. The lower the number, the more is the damage. So 99% is good, okay? And this is glaucoma hemifield test based on Anderson-Patela's criteria, which considers five cluster points above and below the horizontal meridian and compares these cluster points, okay, their sensitivity, and then comes to a diagnosis. So glaucoma hemifield test either normal or it could be borderline, or there could be generalized reduction of sensitivity, or it could be outside normal limits. Okay. And this is finally the gaze tracking. So you have the patient data, the testing strategies, then the probability indices, or the, then you have the foveal threshold, then you have the numerical data, the grayscale, the total deviation numeric and probability plots, the pattern deviation numeric and probability plots, global indices, GHT, and these are the probability indices. That is how you read a field. Whenever you have a field, start from the top and keep describing as I just told you. So if we come to this field, what is wrong here is that the fixation monitor was off and we don't know whether he fixed it rightly or not. But what we can see here is these points are depressed, okay, which reflects in the grayscale. Here the point sensitivity is minus 3, minus 3, minus 2, but this becomes minus 27, which is corrected for the local factors and becomes minus 25. So this is an early nasal step. This is the right eye, this is temporal, and this is nasal. This is the blind spot. This, again, is a reliable field. You have to start from the top. Okay. What you can see is these areas are positive, 24, 25, but these are less than 0, which reflects in the grayscale. And again, in the total deviation, these are positive or minus 1, but these become minus 15 or 17, which again, deduced for the local factors, become minus 24, minus 25. So this is a inferior arcuate scotoma. Similar, this is the second eye of the same patient, again showing the inferior scotoma. Okay, here, this is a 24-2. What is wrong here is that the foveal mapping was not done at the start of the test. Okay, however, if we see, a few points in the center are good, 23, 28, 27, but most points are less than 0 decibels, which reflects in the grayscale. Okay, even in the total deviation, this goes to minus 30. This is minus 30 less than the average population. And when it is corrected for local factors, it still remains minus 19, 20, whereas the central points are 0 or 5. So these points are good, but the periphery has gone. So this is a double arcuate scotoma or a ring scotoma. But what you see here is the superior area is more involved compared to the inferior area, which gives rise to a sharp step. This is called as a nasal step. Okay. These steps are generally, the scotomas are bigger in the superior area because the inferior field is the first to go, or thinning happens initially in the inferior field. So generally you see a larger scotoma superiorly than inferiorly, although not by rule. This is a 10-2. You can see there's no blind spot mapping. However, most of these points are less than 0, except for these few points, which are 30, 32, which is reflected in both these deviation plots. And when it is charted by probability indices, you have these large scotomas, and this is a small island that is spared. Now, this is the left eye of the patient. So this becomes your temporal, and this is nasal. So this is a small temporal island. Temporal islands correspond to the nasal fibers, which are quite resistant to damage and are the last to go. Okay, the central island corresponds to the macular bundle, and the temporal one to the nasal fibers. And these two are spared quite till the end. This is the field of the same patient of the other eye. I'm sorry, I forgot to hide their identities. This also reflects the temporal island. Important point here is that the point next to the fixation has gone. Okay, this is less than 1%. So this is a macular split. It is important because in advanced cases, when you do a trabeculectomy, there can be sudden decompression, which leads to macular damage, and it's called a snuff out phenomenon. So the patient can lose whatever island of vision he had. This is again a 10-2, but as you see here, the fixation losses are quite high. A stimulus field has been used. So it is not a reliable field. So to make it more reliable, we increase the size of the stimulus here. It uses stimulus 5, which would be 64 mm². This was a 4 mm², this is 64. And you see the effects and the thresholds. You see a small central area that has been spared now, and you can read how much threshold is present at each point. This is a macular threshold or a macular program, okay, which tests 16 points, okay, 2 degrees apart from each other in the central zone. Again, you can see the thresholds. If any one of these points is 0 decibel, it means there is a macular split, and you need to take consent from the patient for a snuff out phenomenon. Okay, now this was your Humphrey's field. Not all patients, you'll be doing fields at your own center. Some of them will come with a field and will show you this. You don't have to be blank absolutely as to ye to maine kabhi dekha hi nahi, now I don't know what is this. You need to at least read out that field, even if it is slightly different. So what is this field? Quickly tell me. A clue would be this, and these
Goldman. Colors. Yeah, sorry.
What is it?
Octopus.
Correct. So this is a BB's cumulative defect curve, and this is seen in octopus. We had pixelated points here in Humphreys. Okay, these are all pixels, whereas in case of octopus, you have these color coded. Okay, the patterns are the same. This is reflected onto a. This is the numeric data. This is the grayscale. Okay, this is the total plot and the probability. This is the corrected, and this is again its probability plot. Okay. But you do not have GHD here. You have a defect curve, BB's cumulative defective curve. So these three lines represent the center one being normal, the above one being 5%, and this is 95%. So 5 to 95% confidence interval. So if your line goes between this, it means it is normal. But if it goes below the 95th percentile, that means there is a damage. If it is parallel, that means it is diffuse loss. But if it suddenly drops towards your right, that means there is a local loss. Now, since it is dropping towards the end, that means the local loss is less. If it were to drop like this, maybe 30 degrees of the field was lost. If it were to drop like this, maybe 60 degrees of the field was lost. So it is similar. You can compare this. Okay. You have similar indices, similar patterns. It can be read similarly. So do not be afraid just because you see something is different. Okay. This is a small comparison of the two. Basically remains the same, similar background illumination. This is 0.4. You have 1 to 5 stimulus in Humphrey, but here you have only 3 to 5. The duration we spoke about earlier, the bracketing technique we spoke about, and the strategies we spoke about. Here it is 10,000, here it is less for a 0 decibel. Now, which field is this?
Goldman.
Goldman.
Very good. It is a Goldman perimetry. It's a kinetic perimetry. So when you're seeing the stimulus from a seeing non-seeing area to a seeing area, the point where the patient sees is drawn as an isopter. These are isopters. Now what is this 11E, 12E, 13E? What is this? What do you mean by this? What is this 5?
Stimulus size.
Correct. So we discussed stimulus 5 would be 64 mm². What is this 4? 4 and E suggest the stimulus intensity. Okay, so you have 1 to 4 stimulus intensity in A to E. In 1 to 4, there's a difference of 5 decibel step in each. Whereas in E to E, you have a difference of 1 decibel step. Okay, so a 4E is most commonly used and it's equivalent to 1,000 apostils. Now, we don't just see glaucoma in one field, we see the progression. Dr. Swapnesh, I'll take another 5-7 minutes max. So we see the glaucoma progression also. For this progression, you need to have 2 baseline fields and at least 1 follow-up field. Okay, so at least 3 fields, which are all reliable. So you can have an event-based analysis or a trend-based. Event means something has happened or not happened. So it is firm. It is based on a predefined change in the parameter. So you've predefined a certain set. If it has happened, there is an event change. If it has not happened, there is no event change. So when you have certain points, okay, you see whether these points have changed over time in the next field. You compare point-wise. Okay. So if you were to take 3 points here, if any 3 points in this field have changed over the next field as well as over the third field, that means in 2 consecutive fields, if they have changed significantly, that would be a possible progression. But if it has changed significantly over 3 fields, it would be a likely progression. However, if the mean deviation is less than minus 20, the progression will not be able to be determined in event-based analysis. Then you have trend-based. This is done by glaucoma progression analysis, GPA, or guided progression analysis in Humphreys. You also have trend-based analysis where you see the trend. This is a new global index, VFI. So you see the VFI. If VFI was initially here in the first field, second field, it was here. I told you 0 to 100 degrees, 100%, right? So if it starts falling, you plot it. You can know the rate of change also. This will tell you whether the change has happened or not. But this will also tell you the rate of change. Okay, so it actually provides the rate and the slope will be providing the kind of damage. Okay. So it will give you how much percent of the field has been lost with the time, how much field is likely to be lost, and how much field is preserved. It's a linear regression analysis where a negative slope means progression of the disease. Okay? Whereas in event-based, you'll have certain parameters. It will give you 4 plots in the printout, and it will give you certain parameters. So a circle would mean it is normal. A triangle would mean the change is there but not significant. A half-shaded triangle would mean that the change is significant over 2 fields, that is possible. And a full shaded triangle would mean there is change in 3 subsequent fields, so it is likely progression. So don't just read the fields, also see whether they're reliable or not. So whether you should give importance to diagnosis of that field or not. So here you see the fovea is off, but the fixation errors are 13 by 13. It's a 30-2, but you cannot see any blind spot. It is a right eye, so you're supposed to have a blind spot here. But there is no blind spot. And fixation losses are 30, which is not reliable. Here, you can see fixation losses are 33%. And the pattern I was telling you, what is this pattern called? Anybody?
Clover leaf.
Correct, clover leaf. Now, clover leaf traditionally has 3 leaves, but we have a 4 leaf pattern here. A 4 leaf clover, just for an interest's sake, is considered to be lucky. It is used in St. Patrick's Day. Now, here is another field. So you can see the superior area has been lost. There are scotomas here, although it seems to be reliable. So what can happen is these can be either rim defects if the patient is using a half rim glasses, or patient is fatigued and is developing ptosis. These cases can have these superior defects. So there can be 8 degrees of loss with every mm of grouping. Okay. So ptosis or dermatochelasis, blepharochelasis, fatigue, or inattentiveness can lead to this. Now, certain times you come across this field, which gives you alarming. This is a gross loss, but all these reliability indices are good. You can't see it clearly. I'm sorry for the quality of the field, but these are good reliability indices, but it's an advanced loss. And you see the fundus, it's a 0.3 cup maybe, and you are just alarmed. You don't know what to do. What you have to do is repeat. This is the first field of the patient. Sometimes there can be unexplained damage, which can be seen here, even though reliability, this is a good. When you repeat, this is the field of the same patient. We repeated after 2 days and it was absolutely normal. You can also have other causes of field defects. Everything is reliable. It does not look glaucomatous though. Here you have the blind spot charting and an isolated scotoma near the fovea. Okay, central. Can glaucoma cause this? in glaucoma causes, how do you differentiate it from glaucoma? Any guesses? Random guesses.
Glaucoma is respects the horizontal meridian.
So this glaucoma is respecting the horizontal meridian. Yes. This is lying above it.
Non-edge.
Will it start in the central area or will it start in 10 to 20 degrees?
10 to 20 degrees.
So it will start here. If it was to involve this, there would have been an advanced loss in the other areas also. Mm-hmm. Okay. So even if it was looking glaucoma to you, go back, dilate the fundus and look for any macular pathology which can cause a central scotoma. Okay. Maybe a macular hole or something, or ARMD. If it is an aged patient, this is a young patient. You can also have fields which are respecting the vertical meridian. So now what will you do? What do you have to rule out?
Yeah, bagnaela.
Neurological causes.
So you have to rule out neurological causes. So tell me quickly, what is this?
It's a left homonymous hemianopia.
I am very happy that you said left, because people restrict to homonymous hemianopia. You need to know, whenever we're placing the fields, we always place the field, right field on the right side and left field on the left side. Okay. See it as your own eye. So if you were doing the field of your own eyes, this would be your right eye and this would be your left eye. So you always place the fields this way. When you're doing other ophthalmic things, you write right, left, and then write the findings, right? But here it is put in a opposite way, because this is temporal and again, this is temporal. So this is left-sided homonymous hemianopia. What is this?
Bitemporal.
Very good. It's bitemporal, although I gave you the answer myself. What about this? It's again respecting the vertical meridian.
Pie on the floor.
In what? So what would be the area of pathology here? So left
parietal lobe.
Parietal will lead to pie on the floor. Correct. So always you have to see the fundus when you have these abnormal field defects. So you always need to have a clinical suspicion. Now, what clinical suspicion will you have in this patient? What are you expecting? Before you send this patient for fields, what are you expecting you will get in the fields?
There is an inferior notch.
Very good. What about this? There's an inferior notch. There's a large cup. It's a very deep cup here. There's pallor here and a significant notch. So what would you expect if I were to get...
Superior field defect.
Very good. Expect a superior field defect or a superior arcuate scotoma here. What about this patient? What is the diagnosis here?
Disc hemorrhage.
Okay. So what does it signify?
NTG.
Normal tension.
NTG. Yes.
So if there were field defects in this patient versus a patient who was POAG, say, what would be the difference in the type of scotoma that you would get?
In NTG, it is deeper, steeper, and more close to the blind spot.
Very good. It will be deeper, steeper, and closer to the blind spot. Okay. Now, what about this patient? Does it look glaucomatous to you? Is it
concentrically enlarged cup?
Yeah. So it can be physiological, maybe a 0.5 cup concentrically enlarged. And even the fundus photos reveal a more pallor compared to what you actually see on 90D. It is concentric. There's no notch. What else do you see here?
Macular scar, hole.
It's a macular hole. So you would expect a central field defect, which is non-glaucomatous, something like we saw earlier. Okay. What about this patient? Is it glaucomatous?
Papilledema.
Okay, so it's a pale disc, okay, slightly raised. So what could be the diagnosis? One could be papilledema, another could be?
AION.
Very good. So what would you expect?
Altitudinal field defect.
Altitudinal defect.
So you'll get an altitudinal field defect, which is again respecting the horizontal meridian. Can it be glaucoma? Even glaucoma, you get superior arcuate. So why not? This is a superior arcuate of glaucoma.
Crowded disc. It is. If it is a crowded disc, then it is AION.
So first you go back and see the fundus. Fundus is the first thing. Perimetry is the second thing. Okay. So you go back and see the fundus. It doesn't look glaucomatous at all. And if you were to have an advanced loss in one quadrant, there would be some scotomas in the other quadrant also, most likely. Okay. What about this? Does it look glaucomatous?
No.
Pallid edema.
This is an optic pallor. Okay. So it may be optic atrophy. Yeah. So it's pallor. So the fields may either be... there may be concentric contraction of the field, or they may be early, in the early stages, they may be normal. Okay. But what about this? This is also pale.
This is a 0.9 cup.
But this is a 0.9 cup because you can see the various signs of the vessels. Okay, so what
lamina would be dot sign, bayoneting sign.
Yeah, exactly. And it's 0.9 cup advanced. So what would you expect here?
Advanced field loss.
Temporal island will be.
So if you do a 10, here you have advanced field loss. If you do a 10-2, maybe you'll get a temporal island because it is most resilient. So what you have to keep in mind is not all pale discs are glaucomatous. We also have newer testing strategies, which are based on parvocellular, magnocellular, and bistratified cells, because these cells are specific for these particular functions and they are affected early in glaucoma before other field changes happen. So you have short wavelength automated perimetry, you have frequency doubling perimetry, you have high pass resolution and random dot. I'll not be covering in detail because we are anyway beyond time. Can somebody, this is a newer modality of perimetry. Can somebody tell me what this is? You saw those big bulky machines. Now, what is this? Is it a perimeter? Say it out loud. I don't have time to see the chat. I'm sorry.
Okay.
Head mounted perimeter. This is something that is coming up new right now. Various companies have launched their head mounted perimeters and even done comparative studies with the Humphreys 24-2. These have fixation monitorings also. They have threshold standard technologies also, and they can do 24-2, 30-2 central fields also. So a field of this would also appear similar. Okay, to this looks similar to octopus with a curve, defect curve. Okay, so do not see a different field and just panic and tell the patient ki ye to hume nahi aata, ye hamare yahan nahi hota. Okay, that is the take home message. Also, have you ever heard of binocular field testing? You ever check the fields binocularly? Anybody? Can somebody tell me why we would check it? So you can either do testings of both the eyes separately and then interpose them on each other. Okay, in that case, the central areas or the blind spots will be overlapping. So you will have no blind spot in this binocular test. Or you can have both the eyes open and then do this testing. So this is called as a Humphreys Estermann. Okay, Estermann strategy, Estermann visual field testing. It generally checks 120 degrees of the field, but there's a central circular overlap of 20 degrees, which is more important. This is important when we talk about driving. How much can the patient actually work around in his surrounding? So it is mandatory in certain countries like UK and Australia for the legal fitness to drive. Okay, just something that you need to know. And lastly, if a patient has an advanced cup and advanced field loss, you can only preserve what is left and not do anything about what has already gone. How can you help the patient? You can have them disability certified, because the visual field is criteria in the disability certification. This is a new criteria for visual disability. At least have them disability certified. Okay, for any doubts, you can contact me here. And I would like to acknowledge my residents who are so meticulous in collecting all these fields that it's important for me to just include them in my video. Thank you so much. And I'm sorry I took an extra 19 minutes.
It was a master class. Thank you, Dr. Anu. And I'm sure all the residents have benefited from your lecture. And I've already posted in the Bombay Ophthalmic PG group that those who have missed have actually missed a wonderful session from you. So thank you. Next time, definitely we will cover some other aspect of glaucoma and again trouble you to take one more PG lecture for us.
It was wonderful interacting with this audience who was so interactive. Generally, you have webinars and nobody responds. But there were so many chats, and due to the lack of time towards the end, I could not see them. But wonderful interaction with all of you. And I hope you're able to read a little bit of fields the next time you see some black and white chart and not just say this is black, so this is a scotoma, and this is white, so this is normal.
Ma'am, which book to refer to for best reading for glaucoma visual fields?
What are you reading in glaucoma?
Reddy's is the book I refer.
Shields gives a very nice description of all these parameters and testing strategies. And once you've read the theory part, it is all your clinical acumen. So when you're sitting in your OPDs and a patient comes to you, just discuss it with your residents, senior residents, and your faculty. So do your theory first from Shields. Okay, even you read Kansky. Kansky also gives, even though minimal, but it is a good explanation. Okay, and then clinically. Okay. Whenever you see the field, start from the topmost left-hand corner and go up to the bottommost right-hand corner. Okay?
Dr. Anu, I have one personal question.
Yeah,
how to monitor, or what is the importance of MD and PSD while monitoring glaucoma progression? A patient who is already on treatment for 2 or 3 years on 1 or 2 drugs, and we are doing serial perimetries. How do we know whether he is going in the right direction or there is some amount of progression, only pertaining to the MD values and the PSD values?
So first of all, you need to see that all of these fields are reliable. Okay, they have the same strategies. And if all of them are reliable, you see the mean deviations. Hodapp, Anderson, and Pradesh have given the criteria of mild, moderate, and advanced damage based on these MD and PSDs. You compare the MD, okay, like what I told about the event-based analysis in glaucoma progression. It takes into account the mean deviation and the average of these at each particular point. So if the mean deviation is worsening, it is becoming more negative, that means the patient is progressing. And in pattern standard deviations, more than just seeing the value, see the plot, the pattern deviation numeric plot, as well as the probability plot. The numeric plot will give you a great idea when you compare the same point in two different fields as to how the threshold of those fields have changed. So if you're seeing the point which is 6 degrees up and right to the fovea, and it shows 35 dB in the initial field, and then later on, maybe it's become 20 dB. So it's gradually quite significantly depressed. So you can read these threshold values rather than just focusing on that one particular number of PSD.
Anything that once the MD progresses beyond a certain value, like in OCT, mm-hmm. how once you have a glaucomatous damage beyond a certain point, there is no point in repeating the OCTs because the RNFL values below a certain degree cannot be interpreted further. So is there anything similar take home for the MD?
I would say do not go just by one particular parameter. See the whole field, okay, as a whole. And if you're doing 24-2, say, and you're seeing scotomas, and the scotomas are progressing, okay, but the central area is spared, so the perifoveal area or the perifixation area. So you can continue doing 24-2 on a serial basis. And once it starts encroaching onto the perifoveal area or the fixation area, then you will have to probably stop doing 24-2 and go towards a smaller program, that is a 10-2. See how exactly the macula is involved, because that will magnify the smaller area and give you more details about that particular island that is left. So as long as in 24-2 the central area is not involved, you can repeat 24-2. And once it has encroached upon the central area, then you go in for a 10-2. And similarly, you keep doing 10-2. And if it has encroached on the central points, you do a macular program.
Thank you very much. And thank you for this lively as well as interactive session.
Thank you.
Call it a good evening now. And thank you everyone for participating. Thank you.